Okay, I'm going to start, I think, with the next of our gorilla talks, our second gorilla talk. If people are passing by, I don't know, gorilla talks are really casual conversations that Art Asia Pacific are organizing throughout from today to the end of the fair on Sunday. Our next gorilla talker is Anselm Franke. Anselm is going to be curating the upcoming Taipei Biennale, which starts, what's the exact date?
28th of September,
so it starts very soon. When we met, you were actually in Taipei, so obviously you've been traveling back and forth. I'd like to ask you a couple of things about what you've done before and the projects you've worked on. You've been working mostly, I think, in Europe, and up until this project in Taipei, is that right?
More or less. I mean, in the States as well, but let's say in the West, right?
Oh, okay. I was particularly interested in the show Animism, and to ask, because some of the issues there, I think, are trying to deal with something I just mentioned in the talk with Subodh, of this, the relationship of crisis and how we sort of reflect on that. And I thought that that exhibition and the subsequent publication, also called Animism, that you edited, had a different take on, a different sort of reflection on the sorts of changes that might be happening and how they affect practice.
What changes do you have in mind?
I was living in Japan, for example, recently, so there's obviously the question of natural disasters, as well as, you know, nuclear disaster, as well as then economic crisis. So I'm wondering if that type of those sorts of events were in your mind, or how is there a relationship? Where is that exhibition coming from?
There are several possible ways of telling that story. There's not just one. Mm. It sort of functioned like a prism in which lots of things could be discussed, and they were also in the exhibition. But with regards, you know, when you talk about natural disaster, for example, I think a very basic sort of urge to do this exhibition on animism is the need to rethink nature-culture relationships, and then it seemed to me to make sense to go back to that old European conception of sort of the wrong way of treating nature, no, by thinking of it as an animate sort of thing populated by different sort of agents or subjects like spirits or so it's basically coming from taking a detour through history to question, can we actually even think this nature-culture relation differently without falling back in this European 19th century concepts. No? So that was basically where it came from. The exhibition that just closed in Berlin, the fourth installment, finished with the last piece was on called The Life of Particles, where basically the whole theme of the exhibition was folded back onto the Fukushima aftermath, no, in terms of that uncanny life of the radiating particles and the attempts to rationalize them.
And it's in that sense, I guess, it's also a kind of invisible life. There's like the forces that you can't control or see having a very real effect on everything.
Yeah, that's the invisibility is the obvious link, no, this sort of. And of course, yeah, this idea of, you know, these attempts to create a public picture of control, while you know that there's lots of things that escape measurement and scientific control in radiation. Yeah. And Chihiro Minato, the photographer and anthropologist that you may know.
Yes, he's actually contributed to Art Asia Pacific at the end of last year. I know him, yeah.
So he's been traveling around Fukushima quite a lot. I don't know if he showed you what he's been doing. He took these notebooks.
I haven't seen that work. I've heard about it. You can explain, please.
It's quite fascinating. It's like field, field notes, no, of an anthropologist, because that's what he is.
You can.
And one of the things is he's been collecting every day these maps that appear in Japanese newspapers, just to try to understand how sort of the public discourse tries to...
You mean the radiation maps? The radiation maps, the spread of... if you're not familiar, in Japanese newspapers, almost immediately after the disaster, there were maps that look a little bit like weather maps, at least in my mind, that show the spread of radiation clouds, essentially, to show the direction that they're moving in and the changing directions.
Yeah. And then he, next to these maps and the notes he makes... sort of as a diary, he takes photographs of, the photographs are basically, he wanted to observe how nature reacted after the disaster. No, like we know that it's has fatal consequences for human beings and mammals, but how does the rest of nature react to it? Mm. And this stunning sort of conclusion to which he comes is that sort of especially floral life reacts with stunning like beauty, like the landscapes around the contaminated landscapes are now so beautiful as they were never before, no? Like intense colors and something very, as you can see it in the photographs even, no? There's something special there.
It's a strange cleansing thing, and I mean, it's an odd to say it this way, but I know that people who've gone through chemotherapy, for example, often they have the best skin they've ever had in their lives, because there's this incredible purifying process that obviously when you have that too much, it kills you. And so it's this strange relationship. There's definitely a strange relationship between this kind of life-giving, purifying force and yet the same sorts of forces sapping the life out of the environment at the same time, or warping the environment. Because immediately I was living in Japan, immediately certain vegetables in that area became contaminated and basically blacklisted. Spinach, for example, like certain types of vegetables in particular, took up radiation very quickly. Can I ask about the other works in the exhibition formal level? You were talking about animate and inanimate as concepts. How is this reflected in that exhibition? And I wonder if that's influencing your thoughts about Taipei. Big question.
Okay, the last part of the question we'll take as a separate one, I guess. The basic idea of the animism show was a question of how can you tell a story with an exhibition that is not a linear story but still very much a cohesive sort of narrative. And that narrative starts basically, if you want to say that there is a standpoint on animism in the exhibition, yes. Because it basically says, whatever that may be, animism, but it's the most normal thing in the world, right?
Yeah.
So in the sense that we can make the distinction between an animated conversation and a non-animated one, and it's something that's very obvious to us, but very difficult to explain, no? Like the difference between one that is animated and one that's not. Now, if animism is the most normal thing in the world, so then there is no animist and non-animist societies, but there is ways of channeling it. And let's say that 19th century Western modernity is sort of particularly coined by repressing it. And then it just doesn't disappear, right? So it comes back sort of on a symptomatic level in, for example, media and fiction. That's why, you know, early film is populated with these sort of ghostly apparitions and Frankensteins and resurrecting mummies. And so basically the beginning of that exhibition was to, can we actually see the history of that this media history and that sort of realm of fiction and symptoms, no, like hysteria in relation to another history, such as the repression of animism in the West, and sort of read fiction not as fiction but as document. So the exhibition actually treats things like Grandville's caricatures or early, you know, like the ethnographic footage made in the late 19th century with techniques by Etienne Jules Marais. It treats these things like historical documents to tell that story of repressing and canalizing animism and its return in the sphere of symptomatic fiction.
Right. Wow. That's a lot to fit into one exhibition.
Sorry?
Repressing and canalizing, and bringing it back into symptomatic fiction.
Yeah, sort of trying to trace the what happens when it's repressed and channeled, canalized, and how that repression and canalization relates to the return of the what is repressed in symptomatic fiction. Yeah, I mean, like, you know, like reading, there was, for example, in the Berlin version, a new group of artists who's been doing a sort of museological study of the genre of the mummy film. You know? Like this enormously popular genre around the turn of the century of the curse of the mummy. You know? They've been trying to understand the genre and the fact that there's always the same characters in this genre, no? In relation to very concrete history, no? What happened at that moment in Egypt, and how does this fiction of the curse of the mummy directly express an otherwise not articulatable violent relation, no? Of robbery and...
Well, it's funny. I mean, that type of scenario could also be said about late 19th century interest in other forms of spiritualism, seances. Like, there's always this flip side which doesn't get put into the history books, and yet it's very much a part of other forms of social or oral or media histories, for example. A lot of early media experiments played on this type of otherworldly, ethereal, you know, sort of relationships. And particularly like animation, even as a film, as a medium, is very much linked to that. People disappearing and people, all of these notions.
Absolutely, yeah. Yeah, I mean, this is very fascinating also. There was this moment in the 19th century where the whole question of what is a medium was not clear.
Well, yeah.
And it is today not clear, right? I mean, it's like... What is a medium is a very difficult question to answer, and we have now a sort of funny distinction between technological media and personal media.
Well, even the word itself is, you know, a medium as a vehicle for information in a, you know, the artistic sense, or media in the communication sense, or as a vehicle for spirits and somebody who's channeling, you know, ethereal forces and presences, and we use the same word for both, and that still has currency today, I think.
So. To give one related example, no, in the beginning, sort of in the walk, beginning of the parcours in the Berlin Animism exhibition, we had a little media history, like mesmerism, this doctor that did this collective rituals of animal magnetism, where the whole bourgeoisie in Europe experienced sort of trance conditions, which then got more or less banned by the French king. And then, you know, moving from there to a sort of study on trance rituals of Sufi brotherhoods in Morocco and the way they sort of communicate these rituals with the diaspora in Europe through tapes, and even communicate, like participating on this in this rituals with cell phones and so on, where this question of technological and personal media is, you know, blurred, no, like not distinct. And then the last instant on this media question is back to Japan. It's 97, the so-called Pokemon incident. I don't know if you remember that. It was all over the world's press in 97 when this episode of Pokemon was aired that left hundreds of teenagers in states of seizure and even fainting. And immediately, you know, when you read this newspaper clip, clippings, and there's hundreds of them, you are back to the same, very same discussions that were had all over Europe in the 19th century about mesmerism, spiritism, hypnosis, suggestion, the telephone, the telegraph, nervosity, and immediately all this comes back. It's not gone at all. No? Like the moment something like this happens with the Pokemon. And they had to stop the episode, the whole series for several months. A scientific commission has to interrogate what's happening, and they didn't actually clear what never became quite clear what caused that, this kind of flicker effect for sure. But it's a very interesting story.
I'm conscious of the time, and I'd like to continue that conversation, but.
We're running out?
The other part of the question, how is this sort of recent experience and your work going to feed into the sort of process that you have in place in Taipei? Can you discuss how you've been preparing for that and what you might have in mind, and you know, what are you going to bring to a very different context?
It's the approach for Taipei is very different from the animism exhibition was very particularly made to address somehow a dead end or a sort of lock within the European colonial imaginary, and the way that still informs the way we talk about, you know, animism, basically, as, you know, right or wrong and fact or fiction and belief, no, this whole question. And this is very, you know that Taiwan is one of the most spiritual places on earth, and that to make an exhibition like that there would mean a whole different sort of approach, no? Because even the form of the exhibition and the museum as an de-animating, objectifying device doesn't have that sort of history in a place like Taiwan. So the approach in Taiwan is very different. It's what I'm taking from the animism and other previous exhibition experiences is more this trying to use the exhibition as a medium to negotiate history, no? Trying to sort of, you know, play with figure ground relationships and bringing elements of background narratives into
the surface
and folding other things in, and so, and that's something that the medium of the exhibition is so beautifully suited to do, no? Like, so we're playing with museological formats, like so-called museums that are sketches for possible museums, no? Like what if we had a museum for this and this, no? And then we have a series of these possible museums that sort of project histories and the difficulties of musealizing them, no? Like how would they actually become manifest? In some cases it's an incredibly big challenge to even think of what could become a museological manifestation of experience, yeah, for example, and that's something very fleeting and not something that easily can be caged in a vitrine.
Yeah, right. Do we have time? Okay, great. On a more formal level, what sort of things can we expect in Taipei? What sort of practices, trends, or materials have you been looking at with your team as well?
Looking at a lot, I think it's the recent years in Taiwan, there is a very central role to the moving image, no? And that's unique, I think, and something that will also for me is handy, because I like to deal with moving images in the exhibition, and I find it always, it's not that I like every exhibition with a lot of images, moving images is sometimes a pain, yes. But I like the challenge, and I think we, from the curatorial side, there's a lot of space where we can improve the way we deal with it. There will be quite a lot of video work in the in the exhibition, aside from these museums that are sort of structuring the dramaturgy, you know, so the works are placed sort of in a parkour that is marked, delineated by these museums, and that also means that we can sort of put the content, you know, like the content sort of themed content is sort of packed into these museums, which in a way releases the other works from having to comply with, you know, of having to running into this danger of illustrating something, no? And that, I believe, works really well. This, you know, making it very clear that there's these museums where the things there don't have the status of works of arts that are sovereign, that are not here. They are not sovereign. They are brutally coerced into for having to form a narrative so that the other works can be can take place within a themed context, but also be completely free within it.
Right.
And you know, the theme, I don't know, it, we are still struggling with, you know, how to connect the dots, but we've been starting with this beautiful book by David Wang, Wang Dewei, called The Monster That Is History.
It's a 2004 book by author David Wang, or Wang Dewei, called The Monster That Is History, just in case you missed it. How is that related to your approach?
I mean, I think as a historiographic approach, not to attempts to write 20th century history through, I mean, he does that by looking at fiction writing, Chinese language fiction writing from the 20th century, and sort of working out very clearly that, you know, this approach to history is not about history for its own sake, no, that it's about the present and about how this past events and what is kind of recorded, what is left to fiction, and really structures the very space in which we move, no, the imaginary, the language, and so on.
Yeah. It's funny the way you describe that. It mean to me, it's almost like this is all sorts of events, and some of them might get sort of tidied up into the history box, and some of them get relegated into, perhaps relegated is not the right word, but you know, categorized into fictions and other things, you know, and yet they're all perhaps the same stuff, the same sort of basic substance, but we choose to think about some as history and others as fiction, and so on and so forth.
So this immediacy, you know, of so there's a danger always when you even use this word history, because it always already means too much of, you know, like, because in fact it's about unlocking or act sort of opening up the many black boxes that we are dealing with in the here and now, no, sort of boxes where, like, let's say blind spots where there's no real narrative for it, no? Like, and that's, for me, narrative is really important, because it means when you have a narrative, you can negotiate, no? Like, you can move within it, and you can contest it, and so on. And when there's none, sort of things stay still, right? They're sort of
no tension.
Yeah, inertia, no? Like.
Unfortunately, we're going to have to leave it there.
Right.
Sorry.
No.
But thank you very much. That was our second guerrilla talker, Anselm Franke, who's going to be, who is curating the next Taipei Biennale, which will start at the end of September and continue for how many months?
It's first week of January that it
yes.
closes.
Yeah. So lots of time to get there. Yeah. Thank you very much, Anselm.
Thank you.